Okay. Okay, so today we are going to talk about Reactor. So let's go directly to the plan. Okay. So first we'll start with some brief introduction to reactive programming. We'll see what is a publish subscribe pattern. We see what is an operator in Reactor and how do we chain operators. We're going to look in more details about FlatMap, which is the most one of the most complex operators in Reactor. We see how thread switching is done in Reactor, and we will look briefly at Reactor context and Reactor hooks. Briefly, why? Because we are just going to use them to facilitate, let's say, the error handling part. Okay, so reactive programming. So in most traditional API servers, to deal with a large number of concurrent users, request handling are made asynchronous. And these solutions are based on several options, let's say callbacks, future, completable future, and stuff like that. But using this kind of approach, there is always a limitation, like error handling, callback hell. And of course, not to say that these are bad solutions, but just that it has not been designed to deal with the operations that require latency. And the idea behind the reactive programming is to move away from this thread per request model. Okay, so publish subscribe pattern. So publish subscribe pattern is a bidirectional flow, okay, where we have some emitter of events called publishers that will multicast or send events to some registered recipients called subscribers. And this is different from observer pattern. And the key difference here is that subscriber don't know about the existence of the publisher. So the idea is the following: we have a publisher, and using this subscribe signal, we will inform the publisher that there is a subscriber that is interested on this stream. And using an unsubscribe signal, we will redirect the subscriber to the correct subscription. And next, the subscriber can use this subscription in order to request data. And then data will be sent to subscriber using the onNext signal. Okay, so Reactor is a reactive library, okay, based on reactive stream specification. For building non-blocking application on the JVM. And what you have just seen here, publisher, there are two types of publisher in Reactor. We have Flu and Mono. Mono is when you have, let's say, at most one element in your stream. And otherwise, you use Flu in order, if you have like many items or many elements or events, sequence of elements. And yes, those are two reactive publishers which have the implementation of reactive stream specification. And the reactive stream specification is like an initiative to provide a standard for asynchronous stream processing with a non-blocking back pressure. And yes, it enables just to speak the same language, like it enables any implementation respecting the specification to cooperate with each other. And the specification is composed of four interfaces. We have a publisher, subscriber, processor, and subscription. Processor is not covered here, but think of it like a publisher and subscriber at the same time, but it's not covered here. Okay, so now we have seen that we have a publisher, we have a subscriber. Publisher send events to a registered subscriber, and that will it will request data using the subscription, provide the subscription. But sometimes what we want to do is that I don't want to send data directly to the subscriber. I want to first operate on data. Let's say you have a sequence of elements, let's say 1, 2, 3. I want to operate on this data, let's say multiply by 10, for example, in this case, and then send that to the subscriber. And this is actually an operator that will add behavior to a publisher and will wrap the previous one into a new instance. And we will get like a whole chain, a linked chain, such that data originates from the first publisher and moves down until it reaches the original or the last subscriber. And Reactor provides a large set of operators, filter, map, flat map, and we can combine them really easily. For example, as you can see here, don't have to understand this now. It's just to give you an example how it's really easy to combine multiple operators. Okay. Okay, this is just a small example that describes what is actually done deep dive. Let's say that you have a range publisher, okay? Composed of elements from 0 to 9 included. And the idea is that I want to operate on this data by adding one each time, Okay, so to map these items in the range of, let's say, 1 and 110, okay? And I need to invoke this subscribe, otherwise nothing will happen because Reactor is lazy. So I need to inform the publisher that there is a subscriber interested in the stream. And here, so Reactor will add, will create a subscriber by default, so a Lambda subscriber, that will ask for items instead of giving like a specific subscriber. And what will happen is that when this subscribe is invoked, as we have just seen here, like we have a publisher, the subscriber will invoke this subscribe, unsubscribe will get invoked, and then subscriber will request data to the, in this case, it will be a range subscription. And if we see like this request method, what would happen is that it depends on the number of requested elements, but let's say if it's max value, it will invoke this fast path. And it's really easy, like fast path, it's just a loop. You go through each element and you invoke this unex signal to inform the actual subscriber, which is like in this case, it's the child subscriber. And in this case, it will be the map operator, okay? And this map, when it receives this onNext, when this onNext method is invoked, what will happen is that we will apply this mapper. And if everything is okay, we will send data further downstream to the Lambda subscriber in this case, so the last subscriber. And one thing that you need to keep in mind is that each operator will set a producer and a subscriber at the same time. Both. Why? Because an operator needs a publisher because it needs to send data downstream, and it needs a subscriber because it needs to ask data from upstream. Okay. And yes, this is an example that describes a little bit what's happening in deep dive. And we see now we have just seen what happens like in the chain, but what is interesting to see is what happens when this subscribe is invoked. So what will happen is that first we need to get like the last publisher. In this case, it will be the map operator, okay? And then you need to convert this subscriber to make sure it's a core subscriber. So we'll convert this child subscriber to obtain this core subscriber. And then what needs to be done is we need to check if there is an operator, if we are operating on data between the original publisher, which is in this case the range publisher, and the Lambda subscriber, which is the last subscriber. And to do this, we can check, for example, if the publisher implements this interface, it's the optimizable operator. And if it's the case, what we are going to do is we are going to move upstream, like, okay, I will get using this subscribe or return, it will return a new subscriber that is linked with the child subscriber, which is in this case, the Lambda subscriber. Like at the beginning, we had only one subscriber, but using this subscriber or return of the map operator, it will give the actual, like the child subscriber, and it will return a new subscriber, but in this case with the two subscribers linked, so that when this map operator receives the data, it can send data downstream. And then what will happen is that we have to see if there is something upstream, like we have to take the upper publisher. In this case, it's the range publisher. And what we will use, this next optimizable source. We invoke this method in order to get the upper publisher. And then when we get this upper publisher, we will invoke again subscribe or return in order to link this whole chain, all these three subscribers. And then if after, like, let's say we are here in the range publisher, what will happen is that we will try again to take the upper publisher. But in this case, there is no upper publisher. So I can break directly and invoke the subscribe, so trigger the actual original emission of data. And then everything will go like we have just seen here. Like we subscribe, unsubscribe, and it will request, and the data will be sent downstream using our next signal. So small recall here. So first thing is to get the current publisher. Then we convert the actual subscriber. We get the subscriber of the current operator. We take the upper publisher. And then if original data or original publisher is reached, it's time to subscribe. We just invoke subscribe signal. And then as we have chained recursively the whole chain, it will send data from the original publisher to the last one. And why this subscriber return, if I don't know if you have noticed something, is that sometimes it returns when the subscriber returned with this subscribe or return is equal to null. This happened, we'll see that later, is when, like, say we want to subscribe in another thread. So it's like I'm saying, okay, so I will subscribe myself in another thread and don't pay attention to that. You can finish. I'm just returning now. Okay, so just an example to illustrate what you have just seen here. So you have, let's say, a few dot from iterable. So it's a list that contains items of 1 and 2, okay? We would like to send these items one after the other. So, but to the subscriber, but we want to apply, let's say that these items will generate some publishers inside this flat map. We will see this flat map later, but think of it like an operator that will generate a publisher each time. Let's say, imagine that it's just a map, okay? And what will happen is that when we send an item in this to this first flat map operator, it will generate another publisher. It will send data downstream down to the subscriber. Okay, so now let's come back to this slide. So when subscribe is invoked, what will happen is that it will ask for another subscriber, but where, like, what we are given, like this actual subscriber is linked with the previous one. So we will invoke again next optimizable source to get the upper publisher and ask again for this subscribe or return in order to link this tree. And again, next optimizable source in order to link this whole chain. And then what will happen is that I will again ask for next optimizable source. In this case, it will be null. And then it's time to subscribe. I will subscribe. And then we will have like a wave of unsubscribe because each operator will receive the subscription to which request data. So each one would have like its actual subscriber. So it's child subscriber to which it has to send data and the subscription to request data. When it reaches the lambda subscriber, so the last subscriber, it will request for data. This this operator will ask for data and this one will also ask for data. And yes, when the original publisher received the request, it will just send data one after the other. So it will like send first on X and this will apply a we will operate on this item to generate a publisher. It will generate some value. So we will send this up again downstream. And again, this one will send data downstream. So this illustrates just what you have just seen here. Okay. Now, operator fusion is a cutting edge research topic in the field of reactive programming. And the idea is we want to achieve optimization by fusing multiple operators in a certain way to reduce overhead, like say execution time and memory. And the microfusion is aimed to minimize overhead by reducing some synchronization or sharing some data structure as queues. And this whole optimization is based on queue subscription. And the idea is the following. What we have just seen here is that we will like receive the subscription and we will request for data and then we will receive data when our next signal is invoked. And this is done in a push fashion. But what we can also do is that this publisher can, for example, share with us a queue, okay? And instead of requesting data, I can just come, let's say, okay, don't worry, just tell me when the data is ready and I will pull it myself. Let's say that you have a low consumer or something like that. Okay, I will just come and pull it, don't send me data. And of course, we have to define, a fusion mode. Or let's say it's like a protocol to say, okay, for example, let's say if I send you null or something like that, you can start and start pulling data. And yes, this is the idea of queue subscription. So it's just queue and subscription at the same time. And the idea is that upstream can provide not only subscription, but allow subscribers to directly access internal queue instead of instantiating their own. And yes. Okay, now serialized access. So, yes, here, as you have seen just here, sometimes flat map operator, there are some operators where processing would be done in parallel, but we have to ensure that between two operators, only one item is sent downstream. We cannot send, let's say, three or four items at the same time. It would be a complete mess and we would not like control the request in this way and also for back pressure and stuff like that. And the idea of serialized access is to what Reactor uses is it's what we call a queue drain approach. what will happen is that, let's say that we have many many things that that are being done in parallel. We will just like have each one of them, each thread, for example, or each processor will have like a queue, and we will like have a leader that would come and drain the queue one after the other. And even if like, even if it's done in parallel, it will only have one leader that will drain the queue and send the data downstream, let's say, one after the other. And this is what Reactor is doing. So drain the queue for the available items can happen from a different thread to ensure that only one thread can do the work. And for that, Reactor uses an atomic integer, work in progress integer, that will indicate the amount of work to be done. And we atomically retrieve the current work in progress count, and we will increment it by one. And the thread who increments it from 0 to 1 wins the drain, right? And can enter the loop. And any other thread will just increment it further than exit the method.
We have Nicolas, yeah, which might have a question.
Yes.
Nicolas, you're unmuted.
Oh, wow, amazing. Hi, folks. No, my question is just that you mentioned that you can only get one items one by one. But from what I understood, the subscription interface had a send method, and in the send method, you had the parameter for how many items you could request. So did I misunderstand something?
Yes, you can. You can request as many items as you want. Let's say that you request 1,000 items. But between two operators, there is only, there would be, in case, for example, of a flat map operator, one item will be sent between two operators. Even if it's like, okay, I will send you one after the other. I will register what you have, how many items you want. I registered that, but I will send you one after the other until I reach what you have asked. But there will be only one item that will be sent between two operators.
You mean the, okay, understood. So the, you call on next with only one item. Okay,
yes.
Thanks.
No worries. Okay, and yes, this idea, and this is the idea of work in progress, is that I need to ensure that only one thread can send the data one after the other. And of course, I will show that this later is the number of requested elements by default is max value, not for flat map, I will see that later. But it will like each time update this number of requested elements. Okay, so flat map operator. So flat map, the difference between what we have seen before is like we can use here. Let's say here we have map operator, and map operator, as I said, it's like I want to operate on data. Operate on data before giving that to the subscriber. I will apply a mapper, but the idea is that I can use a map operator. I can do it only. It doesn't support parallel processing. And using flat map operator, you can do that. You can, it will project each element from upstream to a new sequence. Let's say that you have one or two, like in this example, you have two items, and it will generate two publishers for each of one of them that will maybe subscribe it in another thread. And then it will be merged. The idea is to be merged and sent downstream. It's like the fork join operation, and the tasks will be executed in parallel. And once completed, we can bind the results. Okay, and when it comes to implementation, maybe I have already used Eric Java, and Eric Java one, what they have done is that they implemented the flat map in terms of merge and map operator. But it was a complete mess. They have changed that in Eric Java 2, I think. And now they are using, I think, I don't know exactly, but I think like Reactor. And how it's done is that, you know, here, when I said I have an operator, a flat map operator, what would happen if you remember this subscribe or return, it will return a subscriber, you know, and a subscriber that will be linked with the previous one, with the next one, okay, to link the chain. And in this case, in the flat map, it will return this flat map main. At this flat map main, it will be like the pilot of the whole flat map mechanism. And but this flat map main, the leader cannot like subscribe to all these streams that we have just seen here. Like it cannot subscribe to the stream generated by this green circle and also the yellow circle, okay? It cannot subscribe to each one of them and send data downstream and make sure that everything is okay. So that's why in flat map, so Reactor have introduced a flat map inner, okay? And the idea is the following. I have this green circle, I have this yellow circle. And this green circle will generate a publisher. And if we want, we can process it in parallel, okay? And it will generate a stream. And this yellow circle, it will generate also a stream. But the idea is that each one of them will be subscribed by a flat map inner. So the flat map, we say flat map main, which is the leader. We say, okay, I have a new value. I have a new publisher. I create the publisher. I get the publisher. I generate it. And then I will create a flat map inner. And okay, so I created the inner flat map. It will subscribe to this stream. And it will like tells to the to this flat map inner, when you complete, tell me. And I will send data upstream. And this is the same thing for this yellow, the layer one. It will like will create a new flat map inner that will subscribe to this stream. And when it's complete, it will inform flat map. And yes, the idea is the following. And I will have an example here. It's quite, I hope it's okay. Okay. So the idea is the following. You have an operator, let's say a map operator or flat map operator, another flat map operator, or an operator that you, that is generating some data. Okay, at this operator will like when it has some data to process downstream, it will invoke this onNext method. And when this onNext method is invoked, the flat map main will say, okay, if it's necessary to generate a stream, so it's like it's not implementing a callable interface or something like that. Okay, I will generate a flat map inner. And this flat map inner, when it's generated, it will subscribe to this inner publisher generated by this value. And when we have this inner subscriber, when it has like subscribed to this publisher, we have to check first that if it implements queue subscription, that is if the publisher expose a queue, okay, to come and pull data in a pull fashion. Otherwise you need to request data and then the publisher would send data using onNext signal. And so we have two cases. Either the publisher implemented the queue subscription or it doesn't implement the queue subscription. In this case, we have to request some data. And let's say we are in the first case, if the publisher implements queue subscription, the request fusion will be used in order to define the protocol, let's say the protocol to be used. And let's say that there is a mode, like let's say if the publisher send me onNext, it's not supposed to send me onNext. That's why it's used, like it sent me onNext with a null value, okay? It's nothing. Okay, it indicates me that pull method can be called. It's like, okay, you can come and take data from my queue. And what will happen. It's like, okay, I will directly invoke drain. It's like I'm telling to the flat map main leader, okay, I have some data to be sent downstream. Can I go upstream? Can I go to the drain loop and drain this queue in order to send data downstream? The flat map main will say, okay, but I need to check if there is already some work in progress. Okay, I need to check. And that's what will happen. If the work in progress is set to zero, let's say, you win the loop, you can enter the drain loop. And when you enter the drain loop, you can start draining. Okay, you drain your queue, but imagine a new flat map inner have just finished. Okay, it's okay. It will also invoke this flat map main drain method. So, okay, but me also, I have some data that needs to be down, needs to be sent downstream. And when the flat mapping will check the wipe in progress, work in progress, it will see that work in progress is not equal to zero. It will say, okay, no, there is already some work being done now. I will just increment it to let this thread know that there is other works that needs to be done. And what if you see here, for example, if the missed, like the work in progress we add and get, we subscribe what we have processed, in this case, let's say one. And if there is no work in progress, more work in progress, like the missed is equal to zero, we break, so we stop. Otherwise, we will again redo the loop, we'll empty the queue of this other flat map inner, let's say. And then, yes, we will just send the data downstream one after the other when it's done. Okay, so now I have just discussed the case when we implement queue subscription. So you just subscribe, you define a fusion mode, you send data, you enter the loop or not a train loop, and you send data downstream. But what could happen and will happen is that sometimes and a lot of times the publisher doesn't implement queue subscription. In this case, I need to do it the usual way, like request on next. I cannot come and put data. So because the publisher doesn't share with me any queue. So I request data, so I'm prefetch. It's like, I think 32 by default. And then the publisher will, in this case, it will send me data on using onNext. It will, okay, listen, I have this value that you can send downstream. And what the flat map in will do is that, okay, but me, I have a value. I cannot use like the usual way using the drain and drain loop because I don't have any queue to empty. I only have one value that needs to be sent downstream. And what will happen is that, okay, it will check still. As I said, you cannot send data between two operators, more than one item between two operators. It needs to check if the work in progress is equal to zero or not. And what will happen is if the work in progress is not equal to zero, so there is nothing that there is no work being done actually, it will directly use onNext and send data. But of course, it will increment the work in progress in order to ensure that another thread doesn't enter the loop. Okay, but imagine that there is one thread, okay, that actually doing the work in the drain loop, and I only need to send data downstream. What would happen? I cannot use drain loop in this case. I need to create a queue because I know that this publisher doesn't share any queue with me, but I need to create it as here. I will create the queue if it's not already created for this inner publisher, and I will offer this value in this queue. And then I will invoke the drain method of the flat map. I will say like, listen, I don't have any, the publisher doesn't share with me any queue, but still I created my own and I would like to enter this drain loop now. And it will check, okay, if the work in progress is equal to zero, you can enter. I will increment it to make sure that other thread doesn't enter, but otherwise I will let you enter the loop and you can drain your own queue. And so that's actually what's been done. And yes, and okay. So just a small request. So you have an operator, you invoke a next flat mapping, we can generate multiple flat map inner in parallel if you want. We'll discuss this later. And by default, you can generate in parallel 256, I think. Yes, in parallel, by default, but you can change it. And the prefetch amount of requested data in case publisher doesn't implement query subscription, it's 32, okay? And yes, you can do it in parallel, but it's this method, this drain loop, drain queue strategy or queue drain strategy, make sure that only one data is sent between two operators. Okay, so I hope it's understood by everyone. Okay, now we see the thread switching. Okay, so Reactor by default is single threaded. So by default, there is no concurrency, no parallel computing or something like that, okay? And Reactor is, of course, concurrency agnostic. Okay, it doesn't depend on some specific, I don't know, trading or something like that. And the thread switching of Reactor is mainly divided in two parts, okay? Subscribe on and publish on. Okay, and this method will automatically pass tasks to a worker, okay, which is an abstraction that wraps around a single thread that sequentially does the work given to it. You can actually create, using this scheduler, it will create a worker, it will give you a worker, and tasks will be delegated to this worker. And you can think of it, I repeat, it's not the same, but just think of it like a scheduler, it's a thread pool, and the worker is a thread, but it's not the case. Just think of it like this. Okay, so these two methods are exposed by Reactor, are subscribe on and publish on. What is the difference between the two? The subscribe on, the purpose of subscribe on is to make sure that, you know, this subscribe method, you know, this one, you remember, I told you that you can return null in case there is any processing in parallel being done in parallel and you say like to this actual operator, okay, I will subscribe myself, but it's actually happening here. So when the subscriber returned, when invoking subscribe or return is null, actually we subscribe yourself in another thread. And in this case, we are using this subscribe on operator to make sure that any side effects of subscribe method happens on some other thread. And the difference between, in contrast, the publish on is to make sure that it's like, listen, I will let the stream plays like as usual, but when I receive any data, I will switch the thread directly. It's like, okay, I want you to do upstream what you want, but when I have new data, I need to process data in this specific thread. Okay, so yes, the idea is I have some tasks, scheduler will create workers for me, and this worker have key preference to some scheduled executor service. So they have, it's their own scheduled executor service. And by default, but not by default, for this method, these two, publish on, subscribe on, the worker created for these two methods have only a scheduled executor service of size one. The pool size is equal to one. In this case, there is only one item that can be processed at a time. So there is, but for these two methods, no parallel processing being done by the worker. But of course, you can create a worker that can execute things in parallel if you want. So it's just for these two operators. And yes, scheduler is a key to React asynchronous and parallel computing. It's responsible for creating workers, and you can specify also how and when to execute tasks related to the operation of a chain. And the worker, yes, is responsible for actual scheduling, is the carrier of the smallest unit of task. And of course, yes. And the idea of the worker also is that it will like, let's say that the subscriber, the child subscriber have just canceled the subscription, okay? And the worker will make sure that all the tasks that have not been executed that are linked to the subscription are canceled, and it will not accept new tasks. So this is good. And also worker ensures that the tasks follows first in, first out semantics, which means like first item being received, which will be first processed. Okay, so just to give you, you know, when we have code, it's always better. So let's say here, it's Elastic Scheduler, let's say. This is just the part where you can create a worker. And this worker, you can use it to schedule method. And when you invoke this schedule, it will invoke this worker schedule. And as I said before, it's each worker have its own scheduled executor service, okay? And we will use it like here, okay? This is something that we know. Executor can submit. This is, I think, everyone who is using Java have already used this submit method in a small, normal, let's say, usual executor service. Okay. So this is an example, okay, that illustrates what we have just been discussing. We have a chain, let's say you have a source of data, okay. We are applying some operator here. Then we are using subscribe on operator, and then publish on, and then another operator, and then we subscribe. What will actually happen is that when you invoke subscribe, you use like subscribe or return. Okay, you change these two subscribers. Okay, again, you invoke the subscribe or return here. It will again change these three operators. But listen, here, when you subscribe on, you call this subscribe or return in the subscribe on operator, what will happen is here, is like, I will create a parent task, okay, that will contain like in its runnable method, the subscribe that I have just said before, okay, and it will return null at the end. And that's why when you have this null, it indicates that I will subscribe myself, because in the, if you see this parent, the run method contains only, it's like I'm subscribing, but in this case, I'm not giving like we have seen before the lambda subscriber. In this case, I'm giving this subscribe on as a child subscriber. And we return null because we have already scheduled the parent task that we have just seen here, like this, yes, here schedule, it will invoke this one. And when we submit this, it will schedule the subscription phase. And then it will again, like it's really what we have just seen before. It's like, okay, I would execute what I have already been executing, but on another thread. And it will go up again until it reaches the original source of data. And thus the chain will be linked. And then we will send data on this thread specified in this subscribe on operator. But when publish on receive data, as you can see here, the onNext method, when onNext method is invoked in publish on operator, we directly switch again of thread. You see this try schedule, it's the same process. We will, same idea, we will directly schedule this method, and you will send the value downstream in another thread, so you will switch directly of thread. Okay, so okay, now reactor context. And yes, one of the big challenges that you may face when you move from imperative programming perspective to a reactive programming mindset is how do you deal with threading? And I don't know if you know already thread local, but Reactor it enables a feature called context. It's similar to thread local, but being applied to Flux and Mono instead of thread. And the central idea of this context interface is to provide access to some contextual information that may be useful to access later at runtime. So let's say user creds or something like that. And Reactor context is it's similar to a key value store. Okay, you have a key, you have a value. And it's bound to each sequence and stored upward through the subscription. And of course, this feature is unique to Reactor and doesn't work with other reactive stream specification. And now that we have, okay, doc, I have a reactor context, but I need, there are like three questions that comes to our mind. How do we access this reactor context? And how do we update this reactor context? And how do we define it and where? Okay, so first let's discuss this. I have talked about core subscriber. What is a core subscriber? It's like an usual subscriber, but it implements this current context. It's like it adds a method that can enable me to, let's say, to access the current context of a chain, okay? And this bit would be used in order to access the context. But I need also to know how do we update the context, okay? And for this, we have a specific operator. This is the only operator that can help me to, that can update the context. And how it's been done, you remember this subscribe or return method, when it's invoked, what's actually doing is it's really simple. It's only take this do on context that you have defined in order to apply the, let's say, to update the context. And it will take the actual context and update it and return a new subscriber that is linked with the child subscriber, but with another context. It's like I'm updating the context. And we see here an example is that, okay. I need to, as I said, it's. I need to answer three questions. I need to know how do we access the context of a chain, and this is we can do it using this mono point defect contextual that would give me in this case a context view, and then I need to know how do we update the context. The only operator that can help me to update the context is context write. In this case, it's flux context write. It's only the there are two. There are mono context write, flux context write, but it's the same. It's only one operator, okay, being applied to either if you have mono or flux. And this context write, you need to pay attention because you need to define it always. You need to avoid defining it at the beginning because it will be visible only for upstream. So for example, if I define it here, it will not be visible for downstream because when I use like current context, it will always check the child context, always. So for example, in this case, let's say we have a string as a data, okay? I will send it downstream. So we have a flat map. Flat map, like what we do is like generate a publisher, okay? In this case, I will try to access the current context. Okay, I need to access the current context. The flat map, we say, okay, can you please check downstream what is the context? Okay, it will ask this one, okay. Can you check, do you have any update of the context or stuff like that? No, I don't, you don't have any update of the context. It will return empty context. Again, it will check this context, right? But as we have seen before here, we have updated the context when we use this context right subscriber. So when we will use this current context, it will return another context. So the context that contains another context, a new context that contains the key and the reactor as a value. And we send it down upstream and we will again send it upstream, return it. And then we will have like, we will concatenate in with this value, okay? And that's why we have Spring Reactor. And then when we have some data that will be sent downstream, this flat map inner publisher will be triggered, okay? And in this case, we are accessing again this context, but in this case, we have this context write subscriber that is actually again updating the context. So updating this key. And now it will be triggered because it's, before it was like only defined. And as I said before, reactor is lazy by default. So we didn't use any subscribe here because we didn't receive any value. We just have checked the context in the downstream subscriber. And this is what actually been done. So we use context write to update the context so that when this mono point defect contextual will ask for the context, it will return, will update the key. So actually the key was updated, would be updated in the subscription phase and we will return Java. And that's why we have Spring Reactor Java. And that's why you need to pay attention. How do you use like context write or where do you define it? Because, here we are actually receiving we are returning value like Spring Reactor Java, and we are not like returning Spring Java Reactor. Okay, now reactor hooks. So reactor hooks are like a set of configurable lifecycle hooks that can be used for cross-cutting added behavior on flux and mono operators. We have three categories. We have internal error hooks and also drop-in hooks and assembly hooks. So the idea of the drop-in hooks is they are invoked when the source of an operator doesn't comply with directive stream specification. And the idea is the following. Suppose that you have this chain, okay? And this chain, like, suppose that this operator have sent like to this operator two, incomplete. So I will complete, I will not send you data later on. So I will definitely complete. And then this operator two have received like an error. It's not, it's weird because you had say you have just been saying that you have finished. Why do you send me an error? Because you are not supposed to send me anything after that. And this is where we would define this kind of hooks. Okay, for example, where you this one, for example, on error, it will check like if I receive an error and it's already done. So there is I'm not supposed to receive anything further. We will use this kind of operator. Okay. And the internal error hooks. So, for example, this kind of operator are within the normal execution path. And the typical example is the following. Suppose that I have a map operator, okay, with a function that, let's say, draw exception because you divide by zero, okay? And what will happen is that, okay, I would like to send the error downstream, but what will be done is that I will first use an operator error, it's a hook, okay, that will check first if the exception is fatal. Okay, well, there are some exceptions that are fatal. And if it's not the case, I need to check if there is, I will check in the context if there is any, as you can see here, any key on operator error strategy, okay? And if there is any operator to consume the error, I will use it, okay? And then I will, otherwise I will send the data, I will send the error downstream. Okay, I will let the error play using on error signal. Assembly hooks, these hooks tie in the lifecycle of operators. They are invoked when a chain of operators are assembled, okay, that is instantiated. And the idea is the following. Let's say that each time that I generate a publisher, I would like to update the publisher, get a new publisher. And this is where you would like to define this kind of operator. So for example, in each operator, let's you dynamically change each operator as it is assembled in the chain by returning a different publisher each time. You can see here, for example, when you invoke Flatref, it will make sure that assembly hooks are being applied. Next, it's the error handling section. So when we operate on data, we know that errors are inevitable, okay? So when it occurs, you must make sure your code handles it and gracefully recovers from it. And Reactor offers a number of operators to handle exceptions and errors. We will go through each of one of them in details. Okay, so the first one is on error resume. It's used when you want to subscribe to a fallback publisher. When any error occurs, it's like, okay, listen, if you receive any error, I want you to forget about what happened and to forget about the upstream and to start with this new stream. That's it. As you can see here, you have a flu that contains Reactor, Spring, and Kotlin. And what will happen is that those three items will be sent downstream. That's why we receive them, have received them, okay? Reactor, Spring, Kotlin. But then I draw an error. When the error is being drawn, it will be sent to this operator. This operator, it doesn't handle any error, so it will send it further downstream. And on error resume, say like, okay, but I have received an error. Okay, what will happen is that I will make sure that I need first to make sure that on error resume is not being applied two times. This on error is not being applied two times. So this publisher, it's not been, I don't subscribe to this publisher two times. And why that? Because let's say that the first time the upper publisher have sent me like on error resume, on error have invoked this on error. But maybe when I subscribe to this publisher here, as you can see here, I need to make sure that this on error, this second on error is not handled here, because we will have like an endless loop. Suppose that you have an error resume, you have flip and just you have a publisher, it returns an error. So each time which will subscribe to this view, we will have a loop and will never end. And that's why we need to make sure that that doesn't happen. And then we have our publisher here, and we just subscribe to it using this on error resume as a subscriber. And then we will send the data down, it will send data downstream. And suppose that this publisher have returned an error, in this case, we will send the error downstream because we are not able to treat this error because we are supposed to treat errors that are generated with upstream or that are received by the upstream publisher. Okay, so do an error. So the idea of do an error is like, listen, I want you that if there is any error received from upstream, just do this. And then let the error play and send it downstream. And this is what actually happened here. So we have reactor, we have Spring Kotlin. We have received them, but when we receive this error, so when we finish, this one will start, it will return an error. This one doesn't handle any error, so it will send it here. And this do an error will just invoke, print this, and will let the error play, as you can see here. When you like you have this on error hook, which is this one, you are just going to first check if it's a fatal exception. If it's not, you will try to accept to consume this error, and then you just let the error play. You send it downstream using this on error Okay, then on error continue. This on error continue is really, you need to pay attention with it because it needs to be used with caution because I think it will be removed in the next release, but I still wanted to present it and to say why it's dangerous to use it. And for me, you should never use it and it should never be used because if you don't, even say, if you know what is the done, what is being done exactly deep dive, okay, but even still, you don't have to use it. You can use on error resume for that. And you can see the reactive docs, they are proposing using also an error resume because you should not use it. Okay, so if you want to, the idea of an error continue is the following, is that if you receive any error, okay, produced by any operator, I would just want to forget about it, okay? Maybe I would like to log something, but I would like to ask for more data and forget about it. And the idea is that why it's dangerous is that when you define an error continue, it will generate this subscriber context, which is an old context that will be removed in the next release. It will invoke this context write and will update the context by adding this key on next error strategy. And as a value, we are going this consumer, so this error consumer. Okay. And what will happen is that here, for example, let's say you have reactor, Kotlin, and Spring. And let's say that we are processing reactor, but then I have Kotlin. I have implemented, let's say, a mapper that will draw an error if we have Kotlin. And what happened is that when this mapper receives this Kotlin value, it will send this one to this on error continue function, map operator. It will say, okay, I will just consume this error, process it. And after that, I will request for more data. But this is a simple example, but sometimes you have some examples that are very complicated. Sometimes you use some libraries, you don't know what's happening there. And because this on error continues use this context, it's really dangerous because the context always look at the child context and it can be really dangerous because sometimes there are a lot of examples where on error continues not working good, or at least not working as we would like to, as we are expecting it to work. Okay, an error map. So the idea of an error map is that if I receive any error, I just want to update the exception. So to map it into a new exception, let's say my exception or custom exception, and then let the error play. An error return. So an error return, what it does is like, it's like on error resume, but with a one value. Okay, it's like okay. I just want you to start with this stream that only emits one data to downstream, and then finish. As you can see here, you have this. It uses on error resume, and it will only return one publisher that will generate only one value. Okay, this fallback value, and will return it downstream and complete. For example, here we have reactor Spring Kotlin. What we receive it, so we receive a reactor Spring Kotlin, it's normal. But when we have an error that's been drawn, we are not going to apply this because when on error return will receive an error, it will automatically it's like on a resume, it will subscribe to this flux, to this mono, and return directly. And that's why we have Python at the end. Okay. Now on our stop. Yes, if you want to tell, sometimes you want to terminate on errors. For example, let's suppose you are using on error continue. I have just said that on error continue, it's supposed to neglect errors, but sometimes you still want to terminate if you have like some specific type of errors or something like that. And you can use on error stop in order to terminate on errors. Sometimes, let's say if any I have any error, I want you to neglect what is downstream, whatever, and just stop. And as you can see here, it's like having a reactor Kotlin Spring, and then we draw error if Kotlin, and we just use an error stop. And even if we define an error continue, Spring is not processed, so we are only having a reactor. Okay, so that's it. If you have any question, and thanks for your attention.
So I'm going to free you from unmuting. Voilà. So thank you, Mouad, for the presentation. As I will be launching another poll to get to know how people are familiar with Java, and they already use Reactor and which can experience the algorithms. Let's maybe leverage that opportunity. Oh, yeah, sorry. To also ask you, since when are you working with Reactor?
Me?
Yeah.
I don't know. 6 months.
6 months.
That's, I was working like every day, let's say.
Yeah.
With Reactor. Not every day, but yes, like 2 months every day or every working day.
Yeah. Yes. In which context did you use a Reactor?
Because we have like a collector,
yeah,
that collects some events, and it's using a reactive program Reactor.
Yeah.
And we had an issue because like in my team, we had like only one person that was able to handle collector Reactor. So it was the first time we were using Reactor, and we had issues, and I needed to look at Reactor in more details that was being presented in other books,
yeah,
in order to fix the issue. Because many books are talking about Reactor, but they're not talking about what's happening in deep dive. There is no book so far that is talking about Reactor.
So you felt limited by the kind of let's say document you would find on Reactor.
Yes.
There
is a lot of documentation, but they are just showing you how do you use it, but yeah, not what's happening there.
Yeah, okay. So I see in the audience that people which also one slightly explained, explore the solution. Wow, I don't understand those results. Mm. Yeah, Nicolas is saying that you can write a book now on it. I will stop the recording before we may jump into more open discussion. And if you guys want to grab a drink, feel free to do so. Just let me stop the recording.